All right, you're welcome back. This is New Day. We're live from the studios of TV3, First in News, Best in Entertainment, and it's now time for Health Club. Truth be told, I get flustered having to talk about health issues like cholera in total, year in, year out, in 21st century Ghana. I mean, this is a disease that spreads in places without proper hygiene, you know, places where there aren't latrines to properly dispose of human excreta, where people don't wash their hands with soap and water. I mean, very, very avoidable things. Between June 2014 and February 2015, the Greater Accra region alone recorded 20,500 cases of cholera with 121 resultant deaths. This year, one case of cholera has been reported from the Achimota Hospital. Well, we're discussing the launch of the Cholera Control and Prevention Program, and my guest is Dr. Franklin Isiedubakwin, Director of Disease Surveillance with the Ghana Health Service. Mr. Bakwin, welcome to New Day. I hope you're well.
Yeah, I'm fine.
No symptoms of cholera whatsoever.
No, if I had cholera, I'm sure you I'll be somewhere else. I'm here.
Well, God forbid. But not that it should make us feel any better, but Ghana really isn't the only country grappling with cholera. I recall reading a report from the United Nations Office of Coordination for Humanitarian Affairs in Eastern Africa. And as of January 21 this year, 42,000 cases had been reported in the region with 550 cases of death. In fact, the dimensions of the outbreak now is very worrying because it seems there's a higher tendency for the outbreak to resurface immediately it's been put down. And then, you know, the tendency and the ability to spread in vast geographical areas. What is it with this disease that makes it so insufferable, you know, that makes it such a contagion, that makes it so difficult to contain?
Okay, thank you very much. I think that with urbanization and increasing population, which goes at the expense of access to water and better sanitation, then you have a challenge because the disease has to do with access to water and then having access to good sanitation.
I like that you take that tangent because it's multifaceted. I suppose the end actually is the health problem, which is cholera. But otherwise, you know, it's a confetti of issues that bring about cholera.
Yes, because you see, we as a health sector cannot say that we are stopping cholera.
Yeah.
We contribute to address the challenges. So basically, it's about the numbers that can be brought down to the health sector. But when you have a predisposing factor, like poor sanitation, no access to water, then you are likely to have the challenge. And that's what is happening in other countries. So I think that for as I said, like the UK used to have cholera like about 20 years ago. But with improvement in sanitation and access to water, the disease is no more there.
Yeah.
Because you cannot actually stop the bacteria from entering your country, but you can actually find a way of not getting into contact with human beings.
Yeah.
Because so far as it does not get access to the mouth of an individual, it will just stay idle and go off.
Yeah.
So to address the total burden of cholera, then it means that you need to improve your sanitation. You need to have access to potable water. So going forward, I think that is an issue Ghana is trying to address.
Yeah.
We, our main focus in the health sector is to detect the cases very early that does not become a big problem. I think that is the main issue that we try to address.
Let's look at numbers. You mentioned that earlier. What are the current statistics? I just mentioned how there's been one reported case from the Achimota Hospital. Shivers ran down my spine at the thought of how many unreported cases there may be. So what do the figures say as of now?
Yes, apparently, as you said, for this year, we have only one confirmed case. But, you know, you could be having people who do not have the cholera being obvious. They call them carriers. Yes, but they can still transmit it to somebody else.
Oh, is that right?
Yes, because the issue is that
they may not necessarily have the symptoms of loose stools, frequent stools, but they just might be carrying the bacteria.
Yes. So that is a challenge. So for obvious cases, there is one confirmed. But then we as a health sector, what we try to do is that we have a surveillance system that tries to identify cases very early. So we are saying that if you have somebody who is more than 5 years of age and who has severe diarrhea leading to dehydration, they need to suspect cholera.
What predisposes a carrier of the bacteria to manifesting the symptoms?
No, you see, like disease causation
depends
on a number of factors.
Okay.
The person's genetic makeup.
Okay.
How much you have been exposed to that particular pathogen is also a factor. So people express themselves differently.
I just remember this. 2 years ago, this was in 2014, this is when the outbreak of cholera was rather on a grand scale. A friend and I bought Wache, and I have to tell you where I bought this Wache from, so you don't go buy Wache from there. It was around the Bubuashi roundabout. You know, Bubuashi is around Cocoa Clinic. Anyway, so we both bought Wache from there. We ate the same thing, except that she had some salad, you know, the chopped vegetables. In fact, I have never seen someone reduce, you know, lose weight drastically in a matter of days. It wasn't until, you know, well, way after she was treated that we found out that there were actually terrible sanitary conditions in that area where they don't have latrines to properly dispose of their excreta, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So how is it that the disease has the ability to bring one of about 90 kilos down to about 70?
Yeah, apparently, you see that the disease is actually caused by a bacteria. And that bacteria has what they call toxins. So if you take in, let's say, you ingest something that contains the cholera bacteria.
In her case, the salad.
Yes, yes. Yeah. So it gets into your intestines. Then it gets lodged in the intestine. And then it tries to now pull water from the intestines.
Yeah.
And those things get excreted. So that's the way it is. So the bacteria draws water and then it gets excreted. So far as you have the bacteria and the toxins situated in the lining of the intestine, they will pull in more water and then they will be excreted. And you're losing not only water, you're losing other electrolytes like sodium, like potassium. That's why the main causative, the main way of addressing the disease is about fluid replacement because it's mainly about
she was putting several drips.
So it's like when you are vomiting,
then
you need to put on drip. If you are not vomiting, they can take ORS, which is like replacing the fluid that you have lost.
Oral rehydration.
Yes, but let me say that cholera has a very short incubation period. Incubation period is the time between when you are exposed to a disease and when it starts showing signs and symptoms.
Okay.
For cholera, it can be as fast as 12 hours.
Wow.
So it's been from 12 hours to like 5 days.
Yeah.
Averagely 2 to 3 days.
Yeah.
So I don't know when your friend took the watch.
Yeah.
But you take your watch.
It was one Saturday.
Yeah, you take your watch. If you do a matter of a day, you start losing water. And then it's a sudden onset. You see, fine. As you mean, somebody can have drastic weight loss.
Yeah.
But it could be due to chronic diarrhea. He's having a diarrhea over a period of time.
Yes.
But for cholera, it's a sudden onset. Your friend was there, he's like 90 kilos. Within a short time, you start losing water and drops like 60.
Yeah.
So it's a sudden onset. You are exposed to a bacteria that is an enterotoxin that gets attached to your intestine, draws a lot of water, and that water is shed.
When should one be alarmed? You know, as regards, say, the passage of stools, how often should you go, and when should you begin to worry?
Yeah, you see, every individual has its like a normal flow. So somebody goes once a day, it's fine. Somebody is like every other day. But normally if you're going for more than 3 to 5 in a day, then you need to be worried. So in that case, you are saying that you have acute diarrhea. Then in that case, you need to kind of investigate. But let me say that normally for diarrhea, they come with abdominal pain. For the case of cholera, it is characterized by painless, watery diarrhea. So you'll be there and it's like water is coming. It's coming like that.
And I think that's what is probably the most disturbing factor in there. As assuming there was some pain associated, people would be moved to even self-medicate or to go to the hospital for some medication.
Yeah.
But because of that painless factor there.
Let me say that managing cholera is not about antibiotics. It's about fluid replacement. Okay. When you are giving, you are taking antibiotics, you are just reducing the bacterial load in your intestine, so that it reduces transmission to another person. So really, when you are when you have
the
cholera,
it doesn't seize the diarrhea. Yeah,
it is about making sure that you replace the fluid.
Yeah.
But let me also stress that cholera is characterized by diarrhea, may be associated with or without vomiting. So you don't need to say, "Oh, I'm not vomiting." It's diarrhea, but some may have a vomiting attached to it. But going back, I think that Ghana has had cholera for the past, like, say, 30 years or 40 years.
So, good point. Is this disease, you know, for perpetuity, for eternity? Or do you have a prognosis? Do you have a forecast of when we can say there's likely going to be an end in sight in Ghana?
You see, as I told you, UK had it 20 years ago. Now they don't have cholera.
You're absolving yourself of any blame, the Ghana Health Service, is that to say?
No.
Okay.
What you are saying is that it's a collective effort to address the challenge of cholera.
Mm-hmm.
It's about access to water.
Mm-hmm.
It's about access to sanitation. Yet, a few people may not have this access.
Yes.
So that's how we come in.
Yeah.
We are there to make sure that we educate the average Ghanaian so that they know how to suspect cholera and then early report.
Yes.
We are also there to detect the disease early, that it does not become a big problem. Because as I said, when somebody has diarrhea and decides to go and take whatever and does not come to the health facility, you cannot see it as a health problem. So it's a collective effort involving the Ministry of Local Government, whoever they look at sanitation issues about water, issues about food, then issues about health. So it's a multi-sectorial approach to address cholera. Mm-hmm. We normally tend to be the end result that it manifests as a disease.
Where they manifest.
So we are saying that for this campaign, we are saying that it's a collaboration. So this launch will have local government, you have water, you have health, you have education.
Okay. So let's see exactly what the role of the Ghana Health Service is. I know the Ministry of Health has issued a cholera alert, especially ahead of the rainy season. Oh, by the way, the Ghana Metro has also said that the rains won't come in as much this year. Mm. Let me just digress a bit. Will this make any difference?
Yes, because you see, there are a number of houses that do not have toilets.
Oh.
So people will somehow...
A significant number of houses that don't have toilets.
Okay.
At least around Bubuashi and Kaneshi, where we bought that wache from. Mm. Yeah.
So people will have to pass that thing somewhere. And that thing will be lodged somewhere. So as it rains, it carries that thing and spread across.
Yeah.
So assuming that your case, it's like you go and buy cabbage. Normally, this contaminated water goes on the cabbage. Or some is even used to water the cabbage.
Or perhaps a fly.
Yes.
You know, picked on the excreta,
yes.
and then
it goes to land on your food. So the risk is there. What we are saying is that let's make sure that the person who's eating and the person preparing the food are all conscious.
Yeah.
You must make sure that you're washing your hands with soap and running water.
Yes.
And it's a very prominent intervention. So even if you have the cholera and you wash your hands with soap and running water, it goes off. So you too also eating. When you wash your hands with soap and running water.
Yes, because soap is antibacterial.
Yes.
Otherwise, you can also use your hand sanitizer. Especially
yes.
if you're shaking hands with people very often, like I do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that is a cultural thing which has its negative health effect.
Yeah.
But you need to now make sure that you need to practice hand hygiene, particularly in children.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing is that for this era that we are in, whereby we are predisposed to cholera, we are saying that let's practice hand washing, regular hand washing.
Under running water, with soap and running water.
And that is very important. For our campaign, our theme is regular hand washing is a sure way to prevent...
that's a theme this year.
Yes, and that's what we are hoping to do. So hopefully today it will be launched.
The launch is today?
Yes, it will launch in Aboblochi.
Mm.
And the Minister of Health will give the keynote address. Mm. We are having ministries of communication.
Yeah.
Because we are saying that the Ghanaians must be alerted.
Yeah.
We don't want it to become a big problem, then everybody is calling you.
Yeah.
let's know that the risk factors for cholera abounds in Ghana.
You're right. I question the possibility of averting an outbreak altogether. However, I think that we can do something to contain the disease in case of an outbreak.
Yes, I see that you are an advocate for.
I am not after what my friend went through. Oh, definitely.
Yeah. So I think that we are saying that the media are partners.
Yes.
It is not just about figures. They say they call you how many have died, how many have this. No. The message, because everybody can get cholera.
You just never assume it would be you.
Yes, because 2 years ago, we had a colleague who came from Washington. He's a big guy.
Yeah.
He went to the beach, went to buy shrimps.
When you say big, what do you mean? Size?
No.
Okay. Yeah, of repute.
Yes.
Okay.
Before I realized, the guy is lying in the private facility. Because you are not sure, and you cannot just see the food and say, this can have cholera.
This is infected.
So, as far as you are not sure of the source of the food,
yeah,
you need to be very careful.
Yeah.
They are preaching that you have to eat food which is hot.
Mm.
And then if it's a raw food, then it must be washed thoroughly.
Yes.
And I think
you should be sure that, at this point, you don't even buy fruits and elsewhere from outside and just eat.
Yes.
You should be sure to wash yourself. And you should use brine, you know, salt water or vinegar, you know, or even soap and running water if you have to.
Yes. So I think that almost every year we come and talk about it. But it is because it hasn't happened to people, they think it's far away. But there are records of people who are close to us who are getting cholera.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't need to be a poor person to get cholera. The issue is that if you are not sure of the source of food and water, you can have cholera.
Mm.
And the focus is that make sure that you are learning to wash your hands regularly with soap and running water. And the media should be with us.
Well, yes, we are with you. Yeah. I don't underestimate the importance, you know, significance of such educational campaigns. Again, let me digress a bit. I recall about 3 or 4 years ago when the Ghana Health Service rolled out the malaria free program, and I want to know how you're roping in kids here in this campaign, because my little cousin could sing the song. I mean, malaria free future, this is our dream, roll back malaria, children let's fight, search and destroy all their breeding places. Listen to the words of mosquitoes, like stagnant waters in ponds and paddles, stagnant waters in cans and ties, stagnant waters everywhere. And she swore by this, so much so that nowhere in the house would she allow, or you know, would she just see water puddled up somewhere. How are you roping in kids? Because I think they play such an important role in averting in a situation like this.
Yes, I think that there are a number of partners. There are a number of partners who are involved in this campaign. And this campaign is just taking place in Accra. It's a nationwide campaign.
Yeah.
It's starting in Accra.
Yeah.
And we have support from UNICEF, Global Commodities, WHO, Ghana Education Service. And the idea is that all of these key players will be involved.
Yeah.
We are preaching regular hand washing.
Yeah.
With soap and running
water.
The average Ghanaian washes their hand, but it's in a bowl. So, I mean, there's no work done.
And that's usually after eating. Do
you
realize?
Yes, we are focusing on getting the scent of the food.
Yes.
So it's not about help. Yes.
In the soup, we're going help. Pathetic.
So it's an issue that we
Thank you very much. Dr. Franklin Esiedu Bekwain, Director, DZ Surveillance at the Ghana Health Service. And yes, we're launching, I say we because the media is part, we're launching the Cholera Control and Prevention Program today. Where? Quickly.
We are doing the launch in Aboblosi.
In Aboblosi.
Yes, around the seconds.
Okay. Shop. All right. Thank you very much. So now would be a good time to have your hand sanitizer with you. You know, especially if you don't have access to soap and running water, you know, at work, wherever it is you find yourself most of the day, you should have some hand sanitizer with you. You would never assume it would be you. You know, I never assumed it could happen to my friend until it did. And the weight loss was just drastic. I'm just glad she survived.